Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here. I was chatting with my husband the other night. He saw me putting together this talk, and I said, you know, robots, autism, and God, these really aren't on equal footing. And, you know, I'm curious, can you identify anything all three of these have in common? And he said, no one of them ever responds, no one of them always responds the way that's expected. I was thinking, yeah, for sure. If you know someone on the autism spectrum, they're full of surprises. And those of us who work with technology, and actually I'm curious, how many of you are engineers or scientists who are here tonight? Yes, okay. And how many are more from theology or the religion studies? Small number, all right. And anybody here just because they're interested in autism? Few? Yeah, all right, great. Okay, so this is a challenge to tie these together, but our work actually goes in all of these. And actually, I'm not going to weave God through this whole thing, but the interview with Elaine afterwards is going to draw more into that. So let's start off, though, with a test for you. Are these people or robots? How many people think the girl is a person? Raise your hand. Some hands up. And how many people think the girl is a robot? Ah, you guys have seen some of these, haven't you? How many people think this man is a person? A lot of you may know him. Okay, and a robot. Well, actually, so very good. This is Hiroshi Ishiguro's robot daughter. Rod Brooks says he is a robot. However, he sure looks like a person, but he says he is a robot. He is a famous roboticist. Many of you from computer science, doubly, I think, will know him. So, you know, these days, robots and people are looking a lot the same on the outside. And many researchers are working on algorithms that would run inside them that would make them behave and speak and perceive information and even act like they have emotions in ways that might make them seem even more like humans. These short clips are Ishiguro-san's robots, and actually these have gotten even more realistic lately, and he's got robots of himself too that look really just like him, except they still don't quite behave exactly like him. She, I think, looks a little bit like my son before he had a stomach bug last week. not so good. Here's Ishiguro-san's wife, and let's see, look closely at her eyes when that comes up. Very realistic. Okay, this is the robot. Now, she doesn't quite, I mean, I haven't seen his wife do exercises. Maybe she can look like that. But it doesn't, you know, we've got a ways to go, right, with the rest of it. But the realism is pretty compelling. So why do I bring this up? What does my work have to do with this? And it's, as was mentioned before, affective computing is computing that relates to, arises from, or deliberately influences emotion, other affective phenomena. And many years ago, I was thinking about building machines that had better perceptual abilities. I was reading about how the brain worked, and I kept running into these parts of the brain that were subcortical. I was trying to build a vision system in a computer. I was looking at the visual cortex. But the neuroscientists were saying that these subcortical structures that were involved in memory, attention, and emotion were important for vision. I thought, that's funny. None of the vision scientists at Harvard and other places I'd talked to were looking at anything but the cortex. The cortex was where reason and intelligence were, we thought. Why pay attention to this other old stuff in the brain? Except that it was important for memory, attention, and emotion. And I thought memory and attention were important. I did not want to be associated with emotion. That seemed like a death blow to a woman in science. You know, ick, you know, who wants to have that attached to their name? But the more I dug into it and learned about it, the more I saw, you know, yikes, this is actually looking incredibly useful. It looked like all of our decision-making, our speech, our perception, our rational thinking was colored significantly by emotional processes, and work by Damasio, Ledoux, many others was coming into being around the same time, and we were learning from each other, and I was realizing that machines to be intelligent probably needed emotional skills. Now let's walk through a imaginary scenario here of the need for emotional intelligence. And if you want, you can close your eyes for this part of the talk and imagine the following situation. All right, imagine that you have a deadline or a project that means a lot to you and you're working really hard on that project to make this deadline. It could be a project for class, it could be a paper you're writing for a journal, some other thing that matters to you. You've got to make this deadline, you're head down, focused on it. And while you're tooling away on this project, someone enters your office or wherever you've hidden out to work, doesn't apologize for interrupting you, and doesn't notice that you're slightly annoyed by this interruption. This individual starts to offer you advice, but it's useless, so you express a little bit more annoyance. Now, you all have different ways of expressing your emotion. I want you to just pause for a moment and imagine how you would express your emotion. Would you make a subtle facial expression? Would you be vocal? People come from different cultures. Some are very subdued, some are very expressive. And as he continues with this behavior, however it was you were expressing emotion, you become very clear now. If you were subtle, now you are not subtle. All right, maybe you are speaking to the individual. Some people make gestures to individuals that I will not duplicate here in front of you to tell the individual that they are not welcome. But he ignores your annoyance. And this goes on until finally you basically have to tell him to go away, escort him out the door. Fortunately, he leaves, but before he does, he winks and does a happy little dance. Now, I don't know about you, but I would consider this unintelligent behavior and not welcome. I wouldn't want this individual to be showing up a lot in my office. And yet some of you might recognize this individual. This individual. So for those who don't recognize it, for Mac users and real youngsters who weren't around for Microsoft Office Assistant, this is actually a really intelligent piece of AI, okay? The researchers at Microsoft, some brilliant machine learning, really nice work, but they missed some other skills of intelligence that are really important, and these are the skills of emotional intelligence. So if you can't see somebody is annoyed, it's a real handicap, right? How are you to know that you should change your behavior if you can't even tell that they're annoyed? I was talking with a man on the autism spectrum recently who is on his 24th job. He doesn't read facial expressions. He can't see if the boss is pleased or displeased. To make it worse, he's been taught things like a smile means you're happy. We've been looking at people at MIT who smile when they're frustrated. You know, that's confusing, right? Emotional expressions are enormously complex. Now, a computer or a person, we don't need to respond to every emotion we see, but when it escalates, that's the time to respond. And knowing when to respond and how to respond are extremely important too, and those are also skills of emotional intelligence. And Clippy didn't do that. This wink, happy little dance, well, this may have been great when you're user testing this with people who are paid $50 an hour to come in from a rainy Seattle afternoon into a nice modern facility, and they're given goodies and treated with respect and all kinds of things that make you feel good and happy and like doing little dances. And when this thing does that, that feels good. But hey, you know, when you're working on that important project and you're being interrupted with useless information, that's not the time for it to smile and dance at you, right? That's emotionally unintelligent. The Germans, I like, actually have a word for when you smile at somebody's misfortune. Anybody know that word? Schadenfreude, right. So, you know, we don't like that, right? But if you can't see that you've upset somebody, how do you know, right? So we have been working on technology to help not just computers understand the emotions that are out there, but to help people who have difficulty understanding these emotions. We think it will help them to get along better with other people, especially. Here's an example I want to show you of a robot. Robots have to have these abilities, right? So if you think Clippy was bad, when Clippy does all these things inappropriate, imagine when this giant Asimo or other robot comes in your living room and starts acting happy when you're miserable, right? I don't know how many of you saw the movie AI, Kubrick's AI taken over by Spielberg, where they have the flesh fairs, where they melt down the robots, people who hate the robots. You know, we've already seen pictures of Clippy online, you know, being strung up by a noose and people shooting Clippy. And Bill Gates got the standing ovation when he said Clippy was going away at that conference. So here, I'm going to show you a robot that was built as the doctor work of Cynthia Brazil, a colleague of mine. I was on her thesis committee at the time. This was her Kismet project. And she's gone on to do a lot more, even more sophisticated social-emotional robotics. But this was a first example that I think is particularly interesting.
So another important skill for the robot to be able to learn from people is being able to recognize communicative intent.
Very good, Kismet.
And the way we've done that with Kismet right now is to have the robot recognize by tone of voice. Are you praising it? Are you scolding it?
Where'd you put your body? No. No. You're not to do that. No.
I think it's so interesting that audiences go, oh, when people, you know, get mad at Kismet. Because think about it, if Clippy had been more like Kismet, okay? If when you got mad at Clippy, if Clippy had looked sorry and kind of shriveled up and slunk off like a dog with its tail down, you might have been happy to have Clippy come back later, right? Maybe Clippy by coming back would learn to actually be useful, right? So we think it's really important that smart technology and you know, people we work with too can have the opportunity to sense and respond intelligently to emotion. Now, I have a short amount of time here, so I'm not going to give you the full lecture on how to recognize emotion. I'll just give two highlights of two technologies that represent two of the dimensions of emotion. And these might be thought of as the first two terms that account for the most of the variance. The first is the vertical dimension. The psychologists call it the emotional arousal dimension. We think of autonomic arousal, what makes your heart beat faster, what makes your skin conductance go up, what activates you. If you're falling asleep in class, your emotional arousal is really low. If your favorite sports team is winning or that person you've always wanted to meet comes up and says hi to you, then it's probably really high, right? So things that turn you on, good or bad, cause it to go up. If your favorite team fumbles the ball, it goes up too. I was just being shown some Auburn-Alabama rivalry games, and the Auburn and Alabama fans both went up when the team, you know, the opposing team, when the Alabama fumbled, both fans went up. The Auburn fans actually went up less. The team that made the mistake, their fans went up higher. The frustrating negative things sometimes make you go up even higher. So this vertical dimension captures that. The horizontal dimension captures whether it's positive or negative, good or bad, pleasing, displeasing. And that's an oversimplification, but we're going to look at how to get that information off of the face. And I'll attempt to do some live demos here. We'll see if this works. The first example of the arousal dimension comes from a sensor that we developed at MIT. We called the ICOM. Full disclosure, this is now being commercialized by Affective, a company that I am co-founder and chief scientist and chairman of right now. And this, here's the original MIT version being worn as sweatbands on this girl's ankles. She is on the autism spectrum. She has difficulty communicating with language. She's undergoing an occupational therapy session here. And in this clip that I'll play a short segment from, here's a 45-minute session. You can see two signals going up, down, up, down. The two signals are coming from the two bands on her leg. And we mostly recorded two originally to get rid of noise, but it turns out the two sides are interesting for another reason. They're connected ipsilaterally to the two hemispheres of the brain. So if somebody has a seizure on the left side, we see the left side peak and not necessarily the right one until the seizure spreads. So they actually do carry some different information that's interesting too. Let's see if I can play a little bit of video from her. I'm playing a segment from where she's peaking, and this could be a sign of positive or negative stress. See what you think it is here.
How much?
Nothing on the outside yet. By the way, what you see here, right here, is a zoom in of what's in this little blue window right here. This edge right here is right now in the video. And down here is a little bit of perspective of the signal over time. So she actually, we just missed her fussing, so she was a bit upset. But she gets in the ball pit, and she starts to calm down in the ball pit. There are some other kids in the room making noise, too, so there's some confounding factors in this example. But we see her sort of mellowing out and calming down, and this is consistent with her being in this ball pit. Now, what is this doing for us? Often people describe a person on the autism spectrum as, I just get these heartbreaking letters. Okay, so from a parent who says, my son is a good kid, he's smart, he has difficulty communicating, he's on his fourth school. He has these meltdowns. They appear to come from nowhere. And when the son is, a little toddler, you can put your arms around him, calm him down. But when the son is our age, then it's kind of scary when somebody our age starts to act out of control and the person can become injurious to themselves or to others. And nobody wants to see that happen. But these things look like they come from out of the blue. All right, so that's one perspective. The other perspective, some of these individuals who later learn to type and talk tell us, my meltdowns never came out of the blue. I don't know why they couldn't see how frustrated I was getting. It was increasing frustration the whole time. Third perspective, we're measuring, Matthew Goodwin in our lab and with the Grodin Center has been measuring things like an individual on the autism spectrum in the classroom who looks really quiescent on the outside, very calm, maybe even detached from the world like they need more stimulation. But on the inside, their heart rate is up around 120, 140 resting. Their skin conductance, yours, because I'm showing PowerPoint, is probably going way down to less than 3. We see that with PowerPoint, tends to go down. Live demos goes up, PowerPoint down. Theirs would not be at 3, it might be at something like 30 in cases we've seen. So they might be looking calm on the outside. You think they're calm, you think this comes from nowhere, but on the inside they may be ready to erupt. So a sensor like this lets you begin to see on the outside more of what is going on the inside. And again, we see for this girl, there was some consistency here. She get out of the ball pit, got kind of stressed, got back in it, got calm. Here's an interesting moment where she's getting on the swing, and as soon as she gets on the swinging movement is extremely calming for her, and that downward decay is a nice swinging segment. So if you're stressed at the airport and they've put those rocking chairs in there, you might give it a try. We see some people on the autism spectrum made these great movies online of people who don't have autism diagnosis doing repetitive behaviors, you know, flicking the pen, tapping the leg, rocking. They've got this great footage of Bill Gates rocking in these stressful proceedings. And these are things that we have opportunities to learn from people on the spectrum, how these work and why they do these. So that's one example of building a technology to measure an aspect of emotion that can be used for helping people who have difficulty communicating their internal state to relay that to others. Let's go to the horizontal dimension, the facial expressions. In fact, let me see if I can fire up the live demo of this too. See if it's gonna cooperate, yay. Okay, so while that's going, I'll just say a moment about this. This is the work of my colleague and partner at Affective, Dr. Rana El-Kalyoubi. She started this at the University of Cambridge. And I won't go into the computer vision pattern recognition here. Their publications are online. But with an ordinary webcam, which I'll show you in a moment, you can take the data, process it, and start to interpret facial expressions. The set that the demo I'll show you was trained on is from the University of Cambridge Autism Research Center. Many people on the spectrum, as I mentioned before, have difficulty reading facial expressions, and Simon Baron Cohen put together a DVD of many actors and actresses expressing these states, some of which are shown here, to play games and learn how to recognize these things on each other. The problem, however, is that they'd get good at recognizing the emotions in the game on the computer, but when they'd go to real face-to-face interaction, often it just didn't work for them. They were overwhelmed by the simultaneous conversation or the stress of somebody's eyeballs being this far from them or other social presence factors that could make it really hard to read faces. So we have been working on a real-time mobile portable device that people could take and discreetly put in their glasses. Looks a little geeky still, but hey, we're at MIT. And we can wear this around. I've worn it many times. And it will whisper in your ear the interpretation of the facial expressions of the person that you're talking to. Hold on a second. So let me see if I can try to do a live demo for you of this. Live computer vision with lighting that I didn't test in advance. We'll see what happens here. See if this will work. Here goes my eyesight camera. Hopefully this is going to work. There it is. Yay. OK. So you can see, first of all, it's put orange points on my face. I didn't just stick dots on my face. This is important because when you see the publications online, some groups of researchers around the world just put dots on people's face. So it's good to know the difference. And so it's finding these points using a tracker that actually Google loaned us for this, that was developed originally by Hartman and Nevin and team. And then what it's doing, you can see here, if I nod my head, you see this head nod bar go up. If I shake my head, it recognizes I'm shaking my head, bad kismet, right? So it sees the head shake. Down here, red went up for disagreeing, right? And if I'm like, oh, yes, robot, that was really nice. I liked what you did there, and I'm smiling and nodding, then the purple goes up, and it says I'm agreeing. And actually, when I just stare at it like that, it can tell I'm concentrating. I'm paying attention to it. Which is kind of nice, too, for showing respect for people. I don't know if you've ever walked into a place. I take my sons to the medical center, and it's kind of frustrating when they don't actually even look at you when you go there, right? You're like, I'm here for the appointment with my sick kid, and they don't even look up and acknowledge your presence, right? Doesn't make you feel very good or very respected. But now the technology can see that you're there, that you're attending to it, if you're looking positive or negative, and some other more complex cognitive affective states as well. We have audio for this, too, where it can tell you things like, no, 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 aren't you going to work if it'll talk?
Disagreeing,
right, see? Okay, but agreeing. I have to remember to turn this off for the rest of the presentation or it will interpret my expressions for you the whole time, which is really frustrating. I was once sitting there going, why is the thing talking to me? All right. Quick here. So these are some of the skills of emotional intelligence. And I'm just talking briefly about technology to help people and machines better recognize them here. I'm going to zip through a couple other issues here, and then I think we're going to touch on them more in the interview. All right. So could machines actually have emotion? Like, they can't really regulate emotions without having them, but what would that mean for them to actually have emotion? And this next slide is deliberately intended to be horrible looking and for you to not read the detail. If you're actually interested in the detail, which some of you probably are, the paper's online. But the point is that we can give them all kinds of algorithms and functions, with nifty math and machine learning that are modeled on human affect and animal affect. But this is not, we're so far not coming anywhere near giving machines feelings like what you and I experience when we talk about having feelings. Right now, we give them some functions that behave, in some cases, like emotions function. And here's the other really boring part. Get ready to yawn, for those of you who aren't into the technology here. And this is deliberately worded like this, because scientists are very precise about what we are and aren't doing. So we'll say, machines are now being given internal signaling, regulatory prioritization, and resource reallocation mechanisms that indicate things such as, here's one more mouthful, an important goal has been thwarted. Time to interrupt planning system, request generation, consideration of alternate strategies, interrupt attention system, look for opportunities to implement an alternate strategy. If an expert human asks what state the system is in, you have, hey, robot, what's going on? Then respond with a label here where it's modulated by the load required to process the thwarted goal. Lots of load, bigger N. If a non-expert asks, then depending on how big N is, have the system say the robot is frustrated, slightly frustrated, hugely frustrated, right? People just want to know, is the robot frustrated or not? Is the robot really frustrated? No, the robot has all these mechanisms that are trying to imitate something like that. Does it really feel frustrated like we do? No, it doesn't, actually. We don't know how to build something like that. So we scientists give all this long-winded detail, and then the press comes by and they say, machines have emotion. They have feelings. They feel like we do. And people who aren't scientists out there go, oh dear, now, you know, Picard and those people have given machines feelings and they're exactly like us now. It's not quite like that. It's just that it doesn't translate very well. A theologian came up to me the first time I presented on all the gobbledygook mechanisms, and she said, how can you give machines emotion? That's the last thing that separates people and machines. And I was like, huh? No, it's not. Okay, that's the quick answer. And the longer answer, which, you know, would take a long time, encourage you to go on this journey if you're interested, is that there's a lot more that we haven't even begun to even understand well enough in ourselves to know how to implement. So if somebody says they've written a consciousness subroutine, and there are people saying that, you know, the machine prints out, I am conscious, ask questions about it, okay? Don't just take it on face value. There are aspects of these that people are trying to build, and that's interesting. And maybe they can be built, right? In science, we have to allow for that, right? Maybe it's possible. You can emphasize the yet. We do not yet see any way to build these. Or you can emphasize that, you know, the best minds, you know, at all the different universities working on this get together and talk about this regularly. And as far as I can tell, you know, listening to them and interacting with them, nobody has an inkling how we're going to do any of this with foreseeable hardware, software, and quantum computing and biological computers right now, too. Doesn't mean it can't be done. Just means that we're really not close. What if it could be done? What if somebody did succeed in just, you know, physically constructing a robot that really appeared to function exactly like us? And for some people, that's the test. It equals us if it functions like us. Would that mean that's all we are, that we're only material stuff? And again, no, it doesn't. And I like this quick example of aliens stumbling across instructions to build a radio. And the instructions describe how to build it out of purely material mechanisms. And they follow them, and it comes out just like that. And they turn the dial, and it works, and it plays music. And wow, now they know they've understood music. It's what this physical device creates, right? Without fully understanding, you know, radio waves and all that stuff, they could assume that since they built this and it functions like that, that it works. In fact, you'll hear language like emerging. Consciousness emerges. And I think when you hear people say something's emerging, it's just a shorthand for saying we haven't a clue how it works. You know, we'll just sort of use the word emerge. So keep questioning about things like that, too. So if someday we could build a robot that functions like us, you know, would that mean people are fully explained, it's just the material stuff? No, it doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that we are fully understood. It would just mean that we had matched some of the functions. It would be impressive. A lot of people are working on it, and it may happen. We don't know how to do it now, and we don't know how to build humans. Rod Brooks and I have had some fun talking about this. Obviously, other than the fun natural procreation way of building humans. We don't know how to just assemble them in the way that Rod's trying to do in his lab. Will we ever know how to build a robot like us? And I don't, you know, none of us knows exactly. However, as you know or will discover very shortly, I'm a practicing Christian. And as such, I enjoy reading the Bible. I enjoy learning from it. One of the scriptures in particular that's really compelling as a scientist is this one that says, this is from 1 Corinthians 13. It's read as the love chapter at a lot of people's weddings. If you read on to the bottom of it, you get to this part. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I also have been fully known. Now Paul here is talking about in the afterlife, we will see God face to face if we make it to that that other realm. And we are fully known now. We then will know fully. And I think, some of us scientists kind of want to be there in that other realm, asking the author of all knowledge of all space and time and experience, how are we made, right? And I believe we are fully known. So I believe those answers are there. And maybe we really could know them, at least in that realm, if not sooner. I'll end with that and time for some questions and further. Thank you.
Dr. Picard, thank you. That was a really informative presentation. I feel like I learned a lot. As some of you know, we've been talking recently, one of the things I do for my own research is ask scientists how they understand matters of faith, religion, ethics, those kinds of issues. And one of the questions that I often ask them when I'm doing interviews with them is to tell a little bit about their own faith journey, sort of how did they come from wherever they are to where they are now. And I wonder if I might start by asking you that. So could you tell us a little bit about your own faith journey and how you got to where you are now?
Sure.
Some of the highlights.
Sure. I grew up in a family that was not practicing any religion. And I declared myself an atheist at an early age. We were living down in the South in Atlanta. And the few examples I had of religion, I thought were people who weren't very well educated. So I thought, oh, that's just a bunch of, uneducated stuff. Mm-hmm. I wasn't interested in it. And it was actually, there was this cool family I used to babysit for that was kind of young and hip and smart, doctor, all this stuff. And they went off to Bible studies. I thought that was kind of weird. And they invited me to go to church with them. And I did not want to go to church. That was really irreconcilable to me with what I believed. And they kept inviting me, and it got kind of hard to keep saying no. I was, you can only fake stomach aches about, 12 weeks in a row, and then they finally get the message that you really don't want to go. So finally they gave up on me, and they said, well, maybe it doesn't matter so much that you go to church with us, but, you might think of reading the Bible. And I thought, the Bible's this bestseller, it's this most famous book. I guess to really properly debunk it and to be properly educated, I should read it, right? You can't be a really educated person without having read the Bible. So I thought, okay, I'll just read the Bible and then I'll be done with this. So I got one of those Bibles that had all the little check boxes, read through like 3 Old Testament, 2 New Testament each day for read it through in a year. And, right before that, they suggested that I start with Proverbs. I thought, okay, that's nice. One for each day of the month. That's easy. So I started reading Proverbs, and it astonished me that it was so intelligent, actually. I kind of thought it would be full of all these, like, crazy, mythical, made-up gobbledygook, but instead there was, like, wisdom in every line. And it really opened my eyes that my belief that all of this was stupidity was just not proper. So from there I decided, oh golly, now I gotta read the whole thing to be educated. And then when I got the little one, read it. And as I was reading, it started changing me, I have to say. I felt that the ideas and attitudes I had needed revising. I actually started to believe in God, but I didn't want to let anybody know because it wasn't consistent with what I wanted to be. So I was kind of a closet believer in God for a while. Then I thought, oh, maybe this is just manipulating me, right? So then I decided I should start reading books from other faith traditions and going to visit, maybe not just visit a church, but if I was going to visit a church, I should visit a mosque and a temple and everything else I could find. And the Atlanta area had a lot of that. So I actually wound up doing a special topics class at our school. They had a special program. You could kind of do your own thing. And I was in that program. So I did a bunch of religious studies, and through this process, I went from being sure there was no God to thinking, who am I to say there's no God, to holy cow, I think there's not only a God, but this God is revealed to us through the scriptures, and then there's Jesus, the question of Jesus to deal with, and that one took a little bit longer for me, but then I have through, there's an extraordinary amount of evidence for the person of Christ, not just historically, but in terms of the impact on people's lives. And so now I personally know that impact. It's been quite a journey.
Yeah, and fast forward a little bit to sort of where you are now as a computer scientist working at a prestigious university. How have the kinds of things that you hold to in your faith had an impact on the work that you do? So what is that intersection like for you?
Yeah, it's interesting. The Bible doesn't say use this equation instead of that one or use this worker instead of that. So the kind of science, I don't think it's had that much of an impact. What's had a bigger impact is on really my life in terms of how I treat other people. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I had a privilege of spending a little time this afternoon with students here in the engineering leadership program. You know, and people sometimes ask me, you know, are there Bible verses that have influenced your science? You know, it's kind of hard to find the direct influence there, but have they influenced my leadership style, the way I interact with people? Oh yeah, I could dump 50 on you there, you know, that make a daily difference. You know, the challenge there is enormous, right? Mm-hmm. Treat other people as better than yourself. You know, that sure isn't natural for me, right? Think of others more highly than yourself. You know, that didn't come naturally. Thinking of others, you know, for a lot of us who are just interested in our work, you know, that was not, you know, a big priority.
And sort of think about the issue the other way around. So here you are as a high-level computer scientist. How is that and the kinds of things that you've learned through your work and your education had an impact on how you view a life of faith or your own religious life?
Yeah, I mean, as a scientist, and I know people here are you know, incredibly gifted intellectually, too, and Rice with those highest SAT scores and all, and brilliant people. You're probably like me in that you want to learn constantly. You want to know the reasons for things. And so that is just who I am as a scientist, and it's what I bring to the faith too, right? It's not enough for somebody to tell you this is true, right? I need to know why. What are the reasons? What are the rationale? And maybe there's some other reason that explains that too. So I want to explore all of those paths and make sure that I've thought through this carefully and I'm not hoodwinked or deceived by something, right? Well, especially when you're talking about Christianity, right? Because you're, you know, you're changing your whole structure in your life of what matters most, and you don't want to do that lightly.
Yeah, yeah. So as you were talking, I was thinking, I have a robot. I'm sure most of us do in our lives. The one that I'm thinking of most clearly is my Roomba. I don't know if any of you have those little vacuums, those little robots, and I would say in all honesty that some days I really love my Roomba, right?
So have you named it?
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to share that here, but so, you know, but after you're listening to your presentation, it became very clear to me that my Roomba does not love me, right? So I love my Roomba, but my Roomba does not love me. What does the kind of work you do say about what it means to be human? So I think you started down that road in your presentation, but I want to take us down that a little bit further. What kinds of insights are you gaining either, you know, at this sort of intersection of your work and your faith, and just how do you wrestle with that?
Mm-hmm. Well, first, I think any of you who also work on people, whether it's, you know, brain science or AI, you'll know what I know, which is that when you, you know, the more we learn about ourselves, the more amazing we see there. Mm-hmm. That we're made, you know, like we're just incredible. When you look in detail at how our brains and bodies work, it's like there's infinitely more interesting stuff. The more you learn, the more there's another interesting piece under that of how that works, and another interesting piece under that. There just doesn't seem to be a limit to the complexity and the beauty and just marvelous, you know, fitting together of how we're made. And we don't seem to be getting closer to, it's not like we're able to just, like I could check off the books I read. We can't just check off that we've understood this part. As soon as we've understood that part, it seems to open up 5 new parts that we haven't understood. So it seems to be an ever-expanding set of boxes to check off, not something where we're just suddenly getting it all solved. Ah, humans, done that year, on to aliens, you know, next year. So first, you know, I have even more awe for how we're made. It just doesn't seem like we, you know, are globs that came out of just totally random stuff. There seems like there's something more there. And, you know, that's,
yeah,
makes you ask questions.
Yeah, thank you. I This is an incredibly interesting conversation. I want to provide some space and time for the audience to ask some questions as well. Is that okay if we move in that direction now? The organizers have asked me to give some parameters and some directions to the question asking period. So I'll tell you something that I always say whenever I moderate these kinds of things to give you a little bit of education. Questions are different than speeches, right? So questions, tend to have like sort of an intonation at the end, right? And they tend to be a bit shorter, quite a bit shorter, generally speaking, than speeches, right? So I'll try to keep us on track and try to keep us actually asking questions so that we make sure, you know, to really have a dialogue and to give Dr. Picard a real chance to answer your questions, and hopefully we can really dig into things a lot deeper. Another thing is that there are some folks with a microphone standing here. So as soon as you have a question, we would ask that you actually come down to where one of those microphones are, whichever is closest to you. So there are two here at the bottom level, and there's also one at the upper level. And if you would form a line, and I will try to be really fair and not preference a line in any particular space and kind of call on you, and we'll keep that going. Also, just in the spirit of this event, we are allowing you to text in questions as well. So there is information, if you want to remain a little bit more anonymous, there's information on the back of your program about how to do that. So what you will do is you will, you can text Veritas, V-E-R-I-T-A-S, space, and 41411, and the question will be asked later. We'll go ahead and do that as well. So that's really exciting. So let's just get the questions rolling. Because if you don't ask them live, we already have four text questions ready to go. So see if the texters or the lives can win.
I asked this one by text, but since no one's asking live, I wanted to ask it live.
Okay.
How universal is sentiment analysis, like seeing whether someone's happy? Is it the same across all kinds of peoples?
And like,
I guess how universal is it? Is it applicable to using it for airport security, say, like things like that?
There are studies that show that some of the basic facial expressions, like smiling with happiness, are universal across, you know, all the major or all known cultures, even some of the things like Aboriginal cultures. There are cultural differences, though. Nods and shakes mean different things in some cultures. You know, in India, I still haven't gotten anybody to perfectly explain to me what that head nod thing is. Every time I ask my students to explain that, they just laugh at me, you know, and say, "You'll never get it." So try me. There are also social display rules that are very different in different cultures. So, for example, Japanese people tell me, "Oh, we're very unexpressive. We don't show much emotion." And in business negotiations, that seems to be true. But when you go out to the bar and karaoke afterwards, they make up for it, right? So, you know, I people can be very different, you know, when they're with a small child than, you know, at the negotiation table than out with a boyfriend, girlfriend.
Yeah, over here.
So I'm hoping to tap into your being a computer scientist and sort of a budding entrepreneur and your moral sense. So I'm a philosopher, so I'm always worried about moral things. And you talked about how it's difficult or we have no idea how to build in a moral sense. But we're doing a pretty good job of making a way towards building in an emotional sense. And it seems like, especially with private business pressures, we're going to be deploying these emotional robots at some point in the future. And I'm worried about emotionally reactive robots that don't have a moral sense. Mm-hmm. And if we should have any kind of mechanisms for controlling that, or it's really an invitation for you to speculate about if we should have those mechanisms or what you think they might be, or anything that sort of seems on topic to you about that.
It's a great challenge. There are researchers who are starting to try to build, you know, and talk about and write about ethical and moral machines. And, you know, for those of us who build them, it always comes down to, like, how do you program it, right? Like, what, you know, can you really do that with if-then rules? Does it need some beliefs that it has to turn to reason about? Because you can't if-then rule every possible situation that you can foresee, right? So then, since you can't foresee all these things and just write what to do in each of those situations, what are the principles that we should give it? Who is responsible, right? I remember when we did the book Hal's Legacy based on the computer in 2001, Dan Dennett wrote a chapter, he wanted to call it Did Hal Commit Murder? And the editor changed it to something more scientific sounding, but Dan was really mad about that. He wanted to be, did Hal commit murder? Did he commit murder, right? Is he really responsible for the death of a human being? Or was it just his programmers, you know, who are responsible? And then if it's we programmers who are responsible, well, you know, could we blame it on somebody else, right, who taught us our principles or the lack of, you know, total agreement on what those ethics should be these days? So there are a lot of deep, good questions. They're a great research topic for people. I would say, you know, personally, when I try to answer those questions with principles and I try to figure out what's right and wrong, I'm certainly not perfect at, you know, by any stretch of the imagination at following what the Bible says. I'm, you know, quite bad at a lot of those things, as I think anybody fails at them too. But I find that what it suggests has always, you know, the closer I get to it, the more effective my success is in that area. It's really good advice in there.
I'm going to ask a text question. Is your faith ever challenged by your peers or by your students?
Oh, sure. yeah, I mean, come on, right? I mean, I used to be an atheist, right? I challenged people. I would expect them to do the same for me. You know, some people, the challenges range from, you know, how can you believe in that to, like, I want to understand and talk about that, or how do you reconcile that with, you know, people coming from different faiths or different backgrounds. Some people want to think that, oh, just because you lived in the South, therefore, that's why you've got that virus of religion, you know, or something. No, I can assure you that's not it.
Yeah,
certainly a lot of challenges.
Yeah, a question from the top.
Hi, Dr. Picard. I got the impression during your talk that you kind of think negatively about the possibility of building an exact replica of a human. And correct me if I'm wrong. But do you think that that is a problem socially or personally, that in the future we may build some sort of creation that is exactly human in every sense of the word?
I don't actually, let's see. Do I think it's a problem? No, we already give birth to other humans. If we build it this other way, like I have a colleague actually who's a Christian and a fabulous scientist and at MIT. There are a lot of Christian faculty and leaders at MIT actually. They're not all as out there as some of us, but yeah, she's doing bioengineering, making tissues. You know, you could take that approach and scale it up, right? Eventually, the vision would be to bioengineer every part of us. You know, maybe that will happen. I don't have a problem with that. I have a problem with somebody saying if we've built something that has that function, it means we've understood everything there is about humanity or about being human. Because building a function that does something is still different than saying we now understand fully what it means to be human.
And another texted question. Do you think religion and science agree or disagree? In 30 seconds or less. I added the 30 seconds or less thing. Actually, no, take a little longer.
Can I just say like 42 or something like that? Give the number. people know that reference. So the answer is
42.
The answer is, yes. 42 after I think for a long time. Yeah. You know, I you know, of course we all know debates out there. Vastly oversimplified, you know, evolution, creation. I think, you know, there's the extremes are that I've heard are broken on both ends. You know, there are certainly a lot of disagreement between people who take staunchly opposed views. However, as a scientist and a you know trying to be a Christian, I am I don't have conflict. In fact, I would say I have less conflict than my colleagues. Like my friend Rod Brooks, who's been quite public with a conflict he has, where he believes that we've arisen from random, purposeless processes, and yet there's meaning in his life, and he can't reconcile that. I don't have such a conflict. I believe there is a purpose and a mind vastly beyond what we can comprehend here. You know, any description of God pales in significance to you know what God really is. And we are so when I think of the real God versus the you know trivial sort of attempts to describe God, there is no conflict between that God and faith in that God and science. This God is outside of science, and you know, the author of all knowledge and experience and space and matter and everything. So there's no conflict there. There's certainly awe.
Yeah, up at the top.
Good evening, Dr. Picard. I definitely enjoyed the presentation this evening. Just wanted to ask, in your thorough, in-depth study of human emotions and as that kind of incorporates into computers and processing that through algorithms, has that changed the way that you interact with people? If so, how? And do you have any recommendations as far as you know how we should interact with people through your study?
Yes, it has. Thank you. I've learned a lot. We have a running joke every time we'd show like our emotion cam, you know, at MIT, walk around with it. You know, somebody would say, you know, we need that here. You know, we need that. My spouse needs that. Or, you know, I was talking with the students on leadership earlier today. One of the themes that has become really important in the leading leadership writing is empathy. It's also something Obama talked about when he was elected. How there's, you know, there's need for more empathy in the world today. It's now being taught to kids as part of these emotional intelligence curriculums. And it's easy to define, well, there are lots of definitions of it, so people bicker about that. But basically showing, you know, some understanding of somebody else's emotion, you know, being able to kind of put yourself in their shoes. This is something very hard for many people. It's extremely hard for a lot of people on the autism spectrum, although some of them are actually quite good at it, even though some people think they can't do it. And it's also the case that in what we affectionately call the broader autism phenotype. By the way, Simon Baron Cohen's work at Cambridge was, showed that, I believe it was the, for many people who are on the autism spectrum, their parents were more likely to have studied engineering or accounting, kind of come from some fields more than others. What we find is that a lot of our autistic friends are very comfortable at MIT when they come and hang out with us. And we're like, who's autistic here? Which one? You know, because a lot of people, you know, are just have in highly intellectual communities have a lot of you know different ways they handle social situations and reading emotion. So we have many people we work with who we all use our own technology. I'm wearing a couple of our sensors right now. I've been learning a lot about myself. I've been learning how to empathize better with other people. I've been learning how incredibly effective it is when you actually succeed at doing it. It's enormously powerful. Highly recommend people here, if you don't learn anything tonight, at least learn that, to learn a little bit, promise yourself to learn a little bit more about how to empathize with other people.
Yeah. Let me ask another texted in question. How do you think scientific and technological advancement in robotics have helped autistic children and adults thus far?
You know, I'm not happy with how much we've helped so far. I think there's the bulk of it is yet to come. I feel like we're just on the tip of the iceberg. We've had to do a lot of understanding of what the needs are. We started off thinking the needs were this, and as we got to know people, it turned out the needs are more for control and communication and not for things that just mind read for you. So I think our technology still has a long way to go to achieve the goals that we've set out. However, technology has helped people in the autism spectrum enormously. A lot of people prefer to interact with computers than with other people, and it's given them a voice, and it's given them a place where online they can, nobody knows they're autistic. So, you know, and I've made a number of friends on the spectrum with people who, if you met them physically face-to-face, well, I've seen how other people treat them. They think that they're so mentally retarded that they can't carry on a conversation. They don't talk to them because they think they can't understand what you're saying. They talk to me when I'm with them. And yet, if you have the same person online typing, well, I've had these regular conversations online, and I can tell you the following anecdote. I usually Skype with one individual in particular. She types, I talk, because I don't type quite as fast and as loquaciously as she does. And a couple times we've lost the voice channel. You know how Skype is, it's free, you get what you pay for. So we both are reduced to typing. And it's very clear that one of us is handicapped. And it's not her. You know, she's like, are you there? I'm like, yes, I'm still trying to, you know, get this to come out, because I don't usually, I type papers, I type fast, but I type differently than I speak. Mm-hmm. And she speaks beautifully mm-hmm. through typing.
Yeah, that's great. Yes.
Hello. So I heard earlier when you answered a question, you said that you were comparing your kind of reconciliation with having purpose with your friends who had like a purposeless and couldn't really identify that with how he did have meaning in life. I was wondering if you can elaborate on what you meant by like, what purpose you had or what that purpose was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So there's several aspects of it. I guess the short answer is there's when somebody knows you and expresses that they care about you, it imbues in you a feeling of mattering to someone, right? Like, does anything matter on its own, right? Mm-hmm. It matters if it matters to someone, right? Now, and then it sort of makes you feel even more special if the one you matter to is somebody you admire or is somebody who's done something neat, right? Like, I can remember meeting, you know, a famous professor and, wow, like, he remembered my name, you know. Well, I was the only woman in the class, so maybe that had something to do with it, you know. But these things kind of make you feel good, right? And then if you, you know, if the more powerful and amazing that person is, wow, right? Well, you know, we're told that we matter to, you know, the one that made the whole universe, right? I mean, sounds kind of ridiculous, right? How could we matter? Like, what is man that thou art mindful of him, right? It's etched in the stone at Harvard, which of course was founded as a Christian university on, you know, to help encourage knowledge seeking. By the way, Christianity fully embraces seeking knowledge and learning and understanding, and urges people to do that. So that we matter, wow, I mean, that's pretty important, right? And there's purpose in that, and there's delight in that. And it goes beyond just knowledge of that through the, this sounds a little crazy to those of you who haven't experienced this, and I admit it takes a little bit of adjusting too. But it's also revealed to us that, you know, that God literally, you know, the ultimate empathy, walked in our shoes, right? Came down here as us. You know, this is pretty mind-blowing too, right? It's like, it's not too unlike how many of you have seen Tron, right? You know, where the maker of the game wants to enter into the game, you know? So it's, you know, truly cosmic version of that, right? That happening, wow. And that enters in and, you know, and shares all of that with us and, you know, leaves us with, you know, encouragement and a promise that we can, even those of us who live so much later, can still know this individual, right? So we've got, you know, Christianity's got these sort of three beings, right? There's the author of the whole universe, God. There's, you know, the Tron version, you know, coming down here. That's Jesus. And then there's this other thing called the Holy Spirit, right, that is somehow left with us. Like, you know, what's that, right? But that is something Christians can opt into. It's like the ultimate, you know, I love how Twitter's all opt in for, you know, nobody forces you into some group like some of these old listserv things, you know. This, you know, you're stuck on that thing and how do you opt out of it? So this is all opt in, right? We're told about this. No coercion. You're not forced into it. You opt in. You invite this spirit in. And wow, you're like, you know, able to you know, to have a relationship with this mind-blowing thing, you know? And that's, it sounds pretty weird, you know, if you haven't experienced it, but that gives enormous purpose, and it gives a lot more than that, too. It gives a lot of strength and wisdom and knowledge and peace, enormous peace, you know, just a lot of really useful practical stuff.
Thanks. And, a question from that someone has texted in. You said before that you explored other religions, and the texter wonders, what about Christianity made you stick with it?
I think I saw in Christianity a lot of historical evidence for what was written there. You know, you can, I mean, there are a lot of religious texts that just don't have any of that veracity or evidence behind them. But also it was, you know, going to these different communities, meeting with people, hearing what a difference this made in their lives, and, you know, kind of trying things, right? And Christianity works. You know, I'm actually just kind of really practical. You know, one of the reasons I always liked physics better than chemistry is my physics experiments worked. My chemistry ones always blew up. otherwise, I probably would be a chemist. But I'm really practical. You know, when I tried a lot of these things, Christianity works. And I could introduce you to a lot of people who've been in the same shoes. We have a pastor at our church who's raised Jewish. He's a Messianic Jew now. He believes Christ was the Messiah, but he's also, you know, been all over the world, you know, as a Buddhist monk, this, that, and the other, and this is, you know, this is what works.
You've spoken a little bit about how helping autistic people understand emotion. What have you learned about how we can communicate with autistic people and pull their emotion to the surface? Is it necessary to verbalize questions, to ask them to explain how they're feeling? What are some of the things you've learned?
They're all going to be different. So number one, they say if you've met a person with autism, you've met one person with autism. The thing that those who have had the ability to communicate have said to us over and over is, we need you to see, number one, that we are communicating already, even if we're not using your language. In fact, how many of you have seen the movie WALL-E? You know, okay, oh, yeah, great. So you've got, you know, these two robots, right? Have you noticed they're not using language with each other, and yet they communicate the whole time in the movie, right? They're making little beeps and little, you know, stuff around them. People on the autism spectrum or other people who aren't using language are still communicating. So number one, look for how they're already communicating, and work with that, and show them that you care about that, and that you're willing to work with their way of communicating too. I think that's really important to meet them where they're at, and that's actually one of the mistakes we were making early in our work, kind of assuming, oh, we're going to bring you communication ability. You know, you know, they got it. We need to figure out how to adapt our tools so that they can use them in new ways that extend their abilities.
A short question that's been texted in. What is the green shiny thing on your wrist?
I'm wearing two green shiny things, actually. One is a little pod inside a band that one of my colleagues made in India, and the other is a prototype of the Q sensor that is going to be the commercial version of the ICOM that was on the girls' ankles. So the pod can go in a sweatband on the ankles or wrist, and this looks more like a kind of a clunky wristwatch, and they're both measuring skin conductance, motion, and temperature, three axes. Mm-hmm. So it picks up my gestures, picks up, I should be displaying this to you, you would love this. If you ask me a really emotional question, it goes up. If you ask, you know, oh, God, I know the answer to that, yeah, I'll just go down, really easy. If I could see yours, you would see it going up when you laugh, you would see it going up when you're emotionally connecting with things, and if I prattle on too long with a PowerPoint, it just goes down.
Hi there, Professor Picard. I found your talk very interesting in terms of affective computing, and I just had a question specifically about dealing with machines, bringing the conversation back to robots, and the machines that are cognitively aware. Like, what impact do you see the interface of works, such as like the auto tutor that you worked on, the human-computer interaction aspects, having on the learning process? Uh-huh. And what was one large success of this research, and what still needed to be retooled?
Yeah, so the computer tutoring projects were, there have been a series of them, ones to take computer learning situations where a person's interacting, say, with a software agent, and
traditionally these things just kind of like try to teach you math and see if you're getting it right or not. We went a step further and had the system see if you're looking frustrated and looking like you're ready to quit, in which case it would help you have some meta knowledge about your affect and try to learn how to keep learning, how to persevere when you're frustrated. I think one of the hallmarks probably of people at places like Rice and MIT is that you're probably enormously tolerant of frustration to get to where you are. And a lot of learners aren't, you know, they get a little frustrated and they quit. So we wanted to kind of help them learn that, you know, to persevere through that. So we've had some successes there. Wynn Burleson has picked up that work and continued it in classrooms now. We just built the first working systems in our lab, you know, and ran them with, you know, less than 100 school kids, just kind of to teach the computer the basics, how to recognize that. I wouldn't say it was being that therapeutic for the kids yet, because it was more trying to be therapeutic for the agent that wasn't working very well, you know, to get the technology to work. But now Wynn is starting to report some successes where it's making a real difference out there in kids' learning, and that's really gratifying.
And we have one that's been texted in. Has your faith ever slowed or blocked your scientific research, or vice versa?
I don't think it's slowed or blocked it at all. If anything, it's probably unblocked it. Because when I'm stuck again, in grad school and research, high-risk research, most of what you do doesn't work, right? And you have to just be incredibly dogged about persevering. And I've always felt like I could go pray about these things, and inevitably, I just get these ideas that are pretty neat. The whole idea of affective computing came to me one night when I was, I'd been kind of complaining about my commute, and I was reading in the Bible where it says, don't grumble and complain, you know, so like, okay, I should try this and see if it makes things better. I'll stop grumbling and complaining. This is really hard, by the way, especially once you have a teenage son. and it's who's wonderful, by the way. But you know, it's real. Parenting is much harder than being a professor at MIT, and being married. You know, all these things are challenges in life, right? So you know, I have a long commute, and so I was grumbling about my commute, and so I started praying about it instead. And I just had these really peaceful commutes, and all of the affective computing came to me on my commute one night going home. This whole new area, right after that experience.
And how about the other way? The questioner wants to know, has your scientific research ever blocked your faith?
No, actually not. I think they're both about trying to find out what's true. Mm-hmm. And I'm, this is a journey to find out what's true. And so far, the tests I'm putting Christianity through and the tests I'm putting science through are, you know, the best reasoning and experience tests that I can put things through. And, you know, it doesn't mean that I swallow everything a Christian says. And remember this, you know, to become a scientist, you have to go through all this elite training and education, right? To claim to be a Christian and to say things that Christianity says, you don't need any credentials at all. So there's a lot of junk out there, right? So you don't just want to believe anything anybody says is Christianity, right? There's a lot of stuff that isn't Christianity, that's masqueraded as it, and certainly a lot of things people do that aren't Christian. But the person says they're a Christian, right? And they make all Christians look bad. But again, there's no credentials or certification bar, you know, out there to before you're allowed to claim you're a Christian in the press. So do be careful. But I think scientists, you know, we've learned to be careful. I'm careful and skeptical when a scientist says something that I'm not sure about, right? You don't just take something on faith because a scientist says it either. You test those kinds of things. So, and the Bible actually calls us to prove all things, hold fast that which is good, to test things. So that's completely consistent.
Yeah. All right. Hi, Dr. Picard. Once again, thanks for coming out and talking to us and opening yourself to Q&A. I kind of have a rather, I guess it's like a two-part question, but it's dealing with basically the basic idea of what it is to be human. And I remember in your presentation, you defined, like, how would you define human emotion as opposed to just simple robotic emotion? And it seemed like in the presentation, what I got out of it was that human emotion seemed to hold a higher position purely because it was indefinable. And I guess the second part of it is, if in the future, whether that's in 50 years or a million years? Like, if we were able to figure out the components of human emotion, would that in turn make us not human?
It is the case that we can't fully define human emotion right now. There are aspects of feelings that involve the qualia, the sensorial conscious experience that we don't have algorithmically precise ways to understand those right now. You know, once you can really describe a function and something precisely, you can write an algorithm or a recipe to generate it. So part of the lack of ability to do that is due to the fact that we don't understand it well enough yet. If we do understand it well enough at some point and can write that, I think is what you're asking. As I said with the end of 1 Corinthians 13, I believe at some point we will fully understand it. Now, whether that's, you know, in the realm beyond this one or in this one, I don't know. It could be revealed sooner. I believe we are fully known, so it is fully knowable, at least by God. And so I'm not bothered by that, I guess. I want to know. I'll be the first one raising my hand. How does this work? This is fascinating. So does that make us less human or something in some way? No, I don't think so. I mean, we're still fully human, being known fully by God, you know. Once more of that's revealed to us, that doesn't make us less human.
Thank you.
We're running short on time, unfortunately, but I'll ask you two final questions, one really short and one longer that sadly you'll just have to delve into lightly. Short one, are you hiring graduate students?
Usually, but not this year, actually.
Okay. The questioner is very disappointed, yeah. I think. Only lightly, because of time, sadly. Do you believe that God programmed a sense of morality in us? I like that use of the word program there. Or is it entirely free will?
Oh, golly. Wow, this is going to be a great one to discuss at the reception.
It's a cliffhanger.
Yeah. These either or questions. That'll be another one I raise my hand and ask about there, too. We don't understand free will. That was on my slide, right, of the things we don't understand. But I love that topic, and I love that question. I would love to hear your thoughts on that. So if you want to come up and talk to me about that during the reception, I would love to hear your thoughts on that.
Yeah, and I think John is going to come back and close us off here.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.